Welcome, everyone. My name is Stephen Danhauser, and I'm the chairman of the New York Police and Fire Widows and Children's Benefit Fund, also known as Answer the Call. On behalf of the Board of Directors, I thank you for joining us for our 35th annual gala, which is also our first ever virtual gala. While we wish we could all be together safely in person to honor our fallen heroes and raise funds for their families, we take great comfort seeing all the people logged in to join us tonight. People not only from New York, but from across the country. Welcome and thank you. As we all know far too well, 2020 has been a truly devastating year. In New York alone, we've lost over 32,000 people to COVID-19. Among them were first responders who put themselves at risk while trying to keep all of us as safe as possible. These heroes leave behind families who miss them more than you can imagine, some of whom we are honored to have joining in with us tonight. Please join me in observing a moment of silence in memory of these heroes. These are true heroes, and we will forever be grateful to them. Our organization believes the best way to honor our fallen heroes is to be there for those they loved the most, their families. Since our organization was founded in 1985 by my dear late friend, Rusty Staub, we've distributed over $155 million directly to the families of our fallen heroes. I will turn it over now to our Executive Director, Lauren Profeta, who will say a few special thanks to the people and companies who help make our work possible. Thank you.
Hello. It's great to be here with all of you tonight. As Steve said, my name is Lauren Profeta, and I would just like to say a few quick thank yous to some very special people. First and foremost, I would like to thank our amazing Board of Directors for their leadership and dedication, as well as our terrific junior committee. I'd also like to thank all of our fantastic volunteers, especially our incredible team at Weil, Gottschall, and Mangies, Kelly DeBlasi, Kevin Bostel, and Shane Safer. I would also like to thank my wonderful colleagues, Lydia Marinelli and Rachel Trotta, who I will be introducing you to shortly. When the pandemic struck and we realized we were going to have to host a gala virtually, we had no idea what to expect in terms of fundraising. With all the hardships everyone was personally experiencing the last few months, we wondered whether people would still step up. Would they still support? Thanks to everyone watching right now, we know the answer is a big yes. So many people and so many companies have answered the call for the families of our fallen heroes. While we still have a long way to go in terms of fundraising, we are off to a great start. I'd like to extend a big thank you to tonight's extraordinary gala chairs. And a huge thank you to our top sponsors, as well as all of our sponsors. Please visit atc.givesmart.com for the full list of sponsors, as we received some new pledges very recently. Thank you to all of our supporters and everyone joining in tonight. Thank you for keeping your promise to never forget. To never forget our fallen heroes, and to never forget the families they left behind. Thank you. I would now like to introduce Rachel Trotta, our development manager.
Thanks so much, Lauren. Thanks to everyone's generosity, we have already raised over $1.7 million. And I know that with everyone's continued support tonight, we can raise even more funds for the families of our fallen heroes. To that end, I encourage everyone to check out our silent auction items and to bid and donate generously. The auction closes tonight at 7 p.m. If you haven't registered yet, please do so now. We'll put the auction website on the screen and also include the link in the chat area. Thank you in advance for your generosity.
Hi, everyone. My name is Lydia Marinelli, and it's wonderful to be here with you all this evening. For those of you located in New York City with a view of the Empire State Building, I invite you to take a look outside your windows. In recognition of our 35th annual gala, the Empire State Building is lit up in our color of red and blue to honor our fallen heroes. Now, it's my absolute pleasure to introduce you to a special guest, Saturday Night Live's Colin Jost.
Hey, everyone. I'm just checking in from the offices here at Saturday Night Live. Got some wristbands to prove that I don't actively have COVID. That's the idea, I guess. And I just wanted to take a moment to thank everyone who is generously here tonight and donating their time and their money to answer the call. This is a great group, and I think it's such a no-brainer of a group to support, because it's so good that we have the backs of first responders in their time of need and in their family's time of need, the same way they had our backs for so many years as members of the police and fire departments. So I've always cared about this organization deeply because my mother was in the fire department, my grandfather was in the fire department, my great-grandfather was in the fire department, my uncle was in the fire department, a bunch of my cousins are in the fire department now. You get the idea. It's a real Staten Island community that we've got. So I just wanted to thank everyone and tell you that it's such a great cause. And I wanted to show you this video now and share with you some of the lives that Answer the Call has impacted and some of the great work that this organization does. Thank you and good night.
We met after work, we walked into a bar where we hung out, and I was wearing a Yankee hat. Moira was a Met fan. So she took my Yankee hat off and threw it across the bar. And that's how we met.
My favorite story about my mom, she was a lifeguard. Little kid was in the pool, couldn't swim, he was drowning, and she jumped in and saved him. For me, it just kind of showed being a police officer, it wasn't just a one-time thing. She always loved helping people, and she would do everything that she could for them.
Stories that my mom and family members all told me that he is very outspoken and has such a big heart for people. I love meeting new people, and that's exactly what he did. He met my mom at college, and they, you know, hit it off from there.
It was a blind date, and it wasn't easy the first time. We went out the first date, and we didn't hit it off. But by the second date, I knew he was somebody I wanted to spend the rest of my life with. My husband had two jobs, three, firefighter, a side job, and then a family man. So sometimes he would go to work, and I wouldn't see him for 3-4 days straight. But then when he was home, 24 hours, 24/7 of just him.
On September 11th, I was home with Patricia. My sister called to tell me that Moira was down at the World Trade Center. I knew that I had to go into work. At the end of my tour, I volunteered for another tour, figuring she was going to be working, I'll keep working. We went down to Ground Zero. I found her car, I found her hat, but there was nothing left. 4 stories of rubble. And I knew I had to go home and see Patricia and try to explain it all to her.
Losing him at 2, it was very hard. I miss father-daughter dances and being able to see them at their sweet 16s with their father, and having my own sweet 16 and not having him around physically, but knowing he's there spiritually. It was very different, but my father was doing his job, helping everyone around the city. He was a hero.
I know it was a fire in a high rise. I know he was the boss on the job. He went in with 3 other guys. He had to tell them to get out because it was getting bad and he wanted them safe. He was just gonna check one last room for life. And he went in that room and never came out. I came home that night and my older daughter, Gabriella, was sleeping on the couch. She said, Mommy, where's my daddy? And I looked at her and I said, honey, daddy's in heaven. And she cried for about 2 minutes. And then she said something I'll never forget. She looked at me and said, Mommy, daddy was my hero. And I said, I know. She said, well, I'm gonna be your hero now.
Answer the Call came into our lives almost immediately. We met people from the organization who told us that they were there for us, that they were going to, you know, fulfill the promise that's made to police officers. If you go out there, you can do your job knowing that your family is going to be taken care of.
The people who are involved with Answer the Call and the people that we've met through Answer the Call have been with us for as long as I can remember. I don't remember there being a time where I didn't know these people. They were always there. There was never really a time that they weren't. So it's kind of hard to say what they did do for us. It's more of what haven't they done for us.
Answer the Call has helped my family a lot. It allows me to go to private school and also go to college, which was one of my father's dreams. They really appreciate everything that your family has gone through and they show it. It means a lot that so many people remember my father and honor him because it's been so long. Knowing that they're still here when I'm 20 years old, it means that I have a family. If I ever need them, I can call on them. I wouldn't be able to do what I'm able to do now if it wasn't for them.
Matt would think Answer the Call is phenomenal. I would like to tell, you know, the supporters of Answer the Call, thank you for everything they've ever done for me and my family. It makes a huge difference in our lives to know that you're there. It's like a hand on my shoulder.
As a father and also as a police officer, knowing that so many people still care, we know we can count on Answer the Call. You can't thank those people enough. You can't thank Answer the Call enough. You cannot thank the people who donate enough for the comfort that they give to people like myself.
Thank you for answering the call.
Hey everyone, my name is Jen Lommers and I'm a correspondent at Extra, where I'm currently on set in Burbank, California. I moved to Los Angeles a little more than a year ago from a city I will forever call my home, New York. I've been a longtime supporter of Answer the Call and have served as honorary co-chair of the Red, White, and Blue soiree. I so wish that all of us could be in the same space right about now, but sadly, like so many other things, this virus has taken that away from us too. One thing that hasn't changed is the dedication of this organization to help as many families as it can, especially now. We've lost so many of our first responders to COVID-19, police officers, firefighters, EMTs, our frontline heroes. They answered the call when it was unsafe for us to even leave our own homes. Tyena Scalf lost her husband, Detective Jeffrey Scalf, to COVID-19, and I'm honored to help share their story.
We met in, well, I was in high school. We met end of my junior year, June of 93. He had come up from North Carolina. He was in the Marine Corps. Yeah. And a friend of mine was dating a Marine, and he brought his buddy up to, you know, come to New York for the first time. We hit it off right away. Been together ever since. We got married in 1995. Wow. On Veterans Day. This year, 11/11, would have been our 25th anniversary. Oh, yeah, we were talking about renewing our vows. But yeah, we have three great kids. We have a son, our oldest, Alex. He's 24. Yeah. And we have Maria, 21. And then our little surprise baby, Charlie, who's 6.
So how did you know that he was the one when you met?
It's funny because we were so young and people like, oh, my God, you're crazy. It'll never last. I knew it would. I knew that. I knew how great he was. I knew he was amazing. I knew he'd always take care of me and the family. I just knew.
24 years married, you know, you shared an entire life together. You raised three beautiful children together and then he got sick. Tell me about, was that in April?
Yeah, He passed away April 13th. He went into the hospital. It was the night of April 4th, so really April 5th. It was, you know, after midnight. He had come home from work Thursday, seemed fine, and he was going to eat dinner and just started shaking all of a sudden. And I was like, are you okay? He goes, I can't eat. And he had a fever. I took his temperature. It was about 102 or 103, just out of nowhere. He felt fine before that. A little cough here and there, though. And then, you know, we locked it down. It was tough finding a place to get a test. Mm-hmm. One of, you know, the officers, his bosses, got him in to take a test the next morning. Yeah. And but it was too late. That next Saturday is when he went into the hospital.
Wait, so he got sick. He had a fever. And within about a week, you said, it was when he went to the hospital? A
couple of days. Yeah. So he, you know, the whole next day was like quarantining in the house, you know, staying in his room. But he was walking around, he was talking, you know, and I've seen him sicker, been with the guy 27 years altogether, you know, I've seen him with the flu. I've seen him, you know, and he kept saying he was fine. He could breathe. He kept saying, no, I can breathe fine. It's just, I get bouts when I cough. It hurts when I cough.
Yeah.
And he was malaise, a little tired. He was upstairs. I went upstairs later on that night to give him his medicine, you know, Tylenol and all that stuff. And I couldn't really rouse him. I couldn't really wake him up. Mm-hmm. And I thought he was just really tired. And my son is a paramedic. So I called him. Yeah, he was working and he was trying to talk to him on the phone. And he goes, Mom, you need to call an ambulance. Something's wrong. And sure enough, when the ambulance got here, his oxygen was at 53%.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, which was crazy because an hour before that he was talking. It literally just boom hit him. So he was in you know, acute respiratory distress. They got into the hospital and you know, he was intubated, like everybody was intubated when COVID first came out. And they really did the best they could. I can't say enough. I know they tried. I actually used to work at the hospital. So many friends of mine, you know, were working on him and, you know, they were giving him messages from us because I couldn't see him. Nobody could see him. So that was, he was there for about a week by himself.
To have someone taken from you that unexpectedly, where did that leave you and your kids?
In a complete fog and a daze. Tuesday was 6 months and it gets worse, not better. Yeah. It gets a lot worse. Surprisingly, when you think it can't get worse, it does. You know, like birthdays and things like that. Those are tough times. You know, I got the phone call from Answer the Call and I didn't expect it. And I was like, what? Wait, who are you? You know, they're telling me, you know, they're gonna give us this and they're gonna help us with this. And I was like, wait a second, what? Because I wasn't even thinking about anything like that.
Okay. You're still going through it. I mean,
yeah,
the last thing you're thinking about is like, is someone going to help me? You're just trying to like survive at that point.
Yeah. I mean, I just wasn't even thinking, but then it's like, holy crap. Like that's real. Like bills are an unfortunate, you know, part of life. And, you know, it was just very, very humbling when they called because I didn't know why, like, how'd you get my name? Like, I didn't understand. I didn't know anything about them before this.
Yeah.
So, I just thought it was amazing. I think that it's great that people, you know, pull money out of their pockets, their hard-earned money, and they willingly give it.
I just wanted to thank you so much for sharing your story. My heart is with you and my heart is with your family. And I know the Answer the Call is going to be there for you. NYP is going to be there for you guys. And for sure. I give you all my hugs and all my love. Tiana, thank you so much.
Thank you, Jen. And thank you, Tiana, for being with us today and sharing your story with us. My name is Philip Moyles, and I am the president of the New York Police and Fire Widows and Children's Benefit Fund, also named Answer the Call. Families like Tiana's and heroes like her husband, Detective Scalf, are why we do what we do and why we are here today. In 2020 alone, Answer the Call will help 550 families who have lost a loved one in the line of duty. Due to the COVID-19 pandemic, many of these families are struggling and facing great financial hardship and need our support. They are counting on us to get him through this very difficult period. We need to step up. Our silent auction will close at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. All funds raised will enable us to support the families of our fallen heroes. I'd like to pause now and ask everyone to consider to make a donation by visiting atc.givesmart.com. If you make your donation now, it will be acknowledged on the screen in a few minutes. The families we serve need our help. I will again pause for a minute so that everyone can have a chance to make a donation. No amount is too big, no amount is too small. Please give now. Thank you. We greatly, greatly appreciate your support for our families. Now it is my pleasure to introduce Saturday Night Live's Pete Davidson.
Thank you, Phil. Really appreciate it. I just wanted to say shout out to Answer the Call. It's a great organization that is much needed. And I appreciate all it's ever done for my family and, you know, just great people over there. I would like to introduce Mia Graffagnino, who is the daughter of Lieutenant Joseph Graffagnino, who served and lost his life in the line of duty in 2007.
Thank you for having me. For anyone who knew my dad, knew that he was loyal, funny, honest, always smiling, and above all, the ultimate family man. My dad was always willing to help out a friend or family member and went above and beyond to make sure the people he loved were taken care of. My mom always tells me stories to my brother and I about how he was a better parent than her sometimes. He was the kind of dad that changed diapers, made bottles, and put me and my brother in the stroller and took us out for long walks. He always put me, my mom, and my brother first before anything. The one memory that has stayed with me since I was little was when my dad would come home from work and I would hide under our dining room table waiting for him to come find me. As soon as he walked in the door, he would say, "Where is my little girl?" This is one of the only memories that I have of him since I was so young, but it holds such a special place in my heart. My dad, firefighter Joseph Graffagnino, was killed in the Deutsche Bank fire at Ground Zero on August 18th, 2007, 2 days before his 34th birthday. I was 4 years old at the time, and my brother was only 8 months. On that day, his firehouse was responding to a fire on the 14th floor of the Deutsche Bank building. Him and another firefighter became trapped and ran out of air. Losing my dad has been the hardest experience of my entire life. I've never realized how much it has affected me up until a couple of years ago. Every year that goes by seems to get harder and harder for me because I keep realizing everything that he won't be here for. Dropping me off at college, walking me down the aisle, being a grandfather to my children one day are all things that will be happening without him by my side. I would give absolutely anything to see my dad again. The hardest part is knowing that he isn't here for all the things that you just need your dad for. Growing up, I wish he could have been there to watch me find my passion for dance, spend holidays together, and given me advice. Even though there will always be a void in my heart, I always remember that he is watching over me and he will always be my dad. There aren't words to describe how thankful I am for Answer the Call and all that the foundation has done for me and my family. They have helped us immensely, both financially and emotionally. By hosting events every year, they give all of the families the chance to come together and make it known that we are not alone. All of this support means the world to me and my family. I'm so grateful to have so many people looking out. The one thing that gives me peace is knowing that my dad's sacrifice and his character will never be forgotten. Knowing that he made such a huge impact on so many people's lives makes me so happy and grateful to have had such an amazing dad. And to all of the families and children who have tragically lost first responders close to them these past few months, my heart aches for you. If I could tell you one thing from my experience, it's this. You may not realize it now, but this tragedy has made you stronger in more ways than one. Life will be different from now on, but know that it gets better and you will never be alone.
Thank you so much, Mia. We're all very proud of you, and we're sure your dad is watching down proudly as well. This brings us to the end of our virtual gala. Thank you for joining us tonight and for all your support. We invite you to learn more about our organization and the work we do by visiting our website, answerthecall.org. If you have not yet donated, it isn't too late to do so. Lastly, to any of our first responders, we thank you and we hope you stay safe. Good night, everyone. God bless.